Mariano couldn't come, but he really insisted to send a message and to be read it on his behalf. And that's the message. You can also see it there. So, dear Pierre, I wish I could be in Paris honoring your memory in your presence these days. Unfortunately, I'm so far away in the US, a country that you knew so well, that I cannot afford to travel physically to Paris. I still remember when we met for the first time at CERN, so early as in the late 80s, we are more than collaborators, we are competitors in the field of defective potential and superstring models, a field in which you were working with Mary Kay, Sally Dawson and Jan Hischlief. For a moment, I pretended to compete with you guys, and I soon realized that the collaboration where you, Pierre, were participating was unbeatable. So I gave up and decided that progress would only come from your work and started to follow your paper. This event was the starting point of a very nice friendship and very many scientific discussions in which, whenever we did not agree, you were always right. For me, it was a privilege to be your colleague and your friend, as you are able not only to compete at the highest level in physics, but also to create administrative frameworks for the advantage of present and future young generations. Maybe I should maybe here add something that Pierre was a part of a lot of collaborative kind of grants, in particular with Mariano and Spain. We had, I remember I've been 3 or 4 years in a row with Pierre, in particular in December, in meetings in Madrid. So that's just one example of these grants Pierre was involved. Even if, I continue the message, even if you left us, the scientific and seed you implanted is being used worldwide and your memory will endure forever. Pierre, whenever you are now, you will always be in our hearts. Your friend, Mariano.
So I would like first to thank Emilian, Stefan, Cedric, and of course Stavros, who organized this event in the memory of Pierre. So Pierre was a friend, a colleague of mine, of high appreciation, who had similar age, parallel careers, and similar interests. So he came, and by the way, even without, even outside science, I learned today that he was a fan of skis. but I didn't know. I don't know when we met. He did the Aldo-Physik Theorik 1 year before me. I arrived and I did it in 77. And then he left to Annecy, where he started working on initially on QCD, then on Grand Unification. And there also we had a similar interest at that time. I remember I was working with John also partly, Zangiopoulos, on mass effects in Grand Unified Theories. In some sense we were competitive, in competition. Then in supersymmetry, supergravity, string phenomenology, extra dimensions, cosmology and astroparticle physics, more recently. I want to say that I'm familiar with the book he wrote on supersymmetry. When I started doing this course, I was looking at several books to see which one would be appropriate to recommend to students. And I found that, let's say, contrary to other books like Wessenbacher that has everything, or formulas. His book had no much formalism, but he was describing the main ideas, even in supergravity, and he was giving the results. And I found it useful for students to read it. Of course, if we need to know the formalism, we had to, at the same time, to read other books. So I still recommend it to students when I give this lectures on supersymmetry. Of course. So despite this parallel career and our contacts, we never were in collaboration together. We didn't publish anything together. However, I was in contact with his students, in particular with Emilian. I was in your thesis, and then we became very close collaborators, frequent collaborators, one of the most frequent that I have. We came to Ecole Polytechnique afterwards, before I moved to CERN. We were also in many committees with Pierre together. More recently, the last 4 years, it was the Scientific Advisory Committee of APEC, where I had also similar interests. Pierre was also organizer, as we had many examples today, and the promoter of high-energy physics. Some examples that I experienced personally was the ZDR and supersymmetry, which also I want to say, okay, the supersymmetry was not just the subject, but it was, I think, the whole structure that he put down for the first time that gave a framework for putting theorists and experimentalists together, working groups with interest. And I met many people and could, in many occasions during this ZDR. It was the call in Carzès, which I don't know how many he organized. I went once or two times, which I found also very successful. And of course, he was in a CNRS committee, several commissions of CNRS. He had a career with a lot of mobility, both in international and in France. So he was at CERN and then several places in the States. But also in France, he started with CNRS in a lab in Annecy. Then he moved to Orsay. And then he had this good move to create this lab here, the APC, which obviously has a lot of success and somehow realizes what it's another example of how he was thinking. And another thing of also that was said was his implication in the program of gravitational waves and France participation in LISA. After my return from CERN in 2015, we started approaching more each other, discussing physics and have intention to collaborate really, directly. So the obvious thing we did was we tried to apply for an ANR and ANR grant. So we applied 2 times. The one time passed the second round, but then it was not funded. The second time, which was in the writing, it was in the fall of 2016. We were writing together. So he was coming because he was teaching at the time in. He had some part-time teaching in Zizhie, and he was coming to my office and we were writing the proposal, but unfortunately this was rejected from the first round. So I didn't know, really, I didn't know that he was ill, and then after after a few months, he was hospitalized and he left. And since then, of course, I didn't try again. So Pierre, I think he's going to stay in my memory, but also in all of us. The French physics, I think he lost it, one of his its pillars. And it will stay an example to follow for us, in particular for the young people. Well, thank you.
So, I will be brief. It's late in the day, and we have heard a lot about Pierre. I think I feel I know him better than this morning. Let me start by saying, as Gabriela said, that it has been a sad 1.5 year, actually, for high-energy theory. You know, Gabriela mentioned quite a few distinguished colleagues. Here are two more, Ioannis Bakas and Joe Polczynski. There is, of course, also Stephen Hawking. So we all feel that HEPTH has become poorer these last couple of years. Now, Pierre, of course, is one of these big losses, of these important losses. I think it has been said, and I will repeat it, Pierre was a man of synthesis. You know, he had really a unique combination of talents and qualities for this, which we will very much miss. And this included these very broad interests. I don't know if he coined the term two infinities, did he, Fora? But it's really explaining what he was really interested in. He had a really nice nose for the directions that physics would take. And last but not least, he had both the energy and the taste, because that's not always the case, to do really a lot of community service. He was presiding the CNRS Commission. He put up this ZDR that was a lot talked about, APSE, and so on and so forth. So I think that the main thing that you know, I retain from him is that he was a man who created bridges and who kept reminding, to some of us at least, who are more formal much of the time, how important it is to work hard to maintain these links and these bridges. Within the French context, this means Ian Pei and de Petroin and Insu. Now, you know, before coming here, I just tried to reconstruct my trajectory and Pierre's trajectory and the times we crossed and met. It goes back indeed to more than 30 years, about 30 years. And we met in, as I realized, in numerous occasions. At each time we were crossing, we never really collaborated. I think I first met him in Aix-les-Bains in 1988. This was really a very exciting time. It was a little after Green-Schwarz, and of course, everyone was fascinated by string theory, string unification, and Pierre's talk was about superstring-inspired phenomenology. He was, again, probably one of the few people to coin the word superstring phenomenology. Some years later, actually 9 years later, we were both conveners in an EPS conference in Jerusalem. And we spent a day, I remember, visiting the old town, talking a lot about all sorts of things. But he was such a reserved man that you still didn't feel you knew him outside physics. At least I didn't feel I knew him outside physics. He talked about Yukawas at that time. That's what Pierre discussed in his talk. The next year in Oxford, he talked about Zizou. Actually, it was the day after the World Cup final. He was extremely excited by this, and he started his talk with a picture of Zidane, and then talked about 10 minutes about this before going into some physics that was less interesting this time than the World Cup. Then, you know, it went on. I was in the thesis of Cedric, so I remember very well this very nice work that Cedric discussed in 2000, and so on and so forth. For many years in the DEA de Physique Théorique, he was actually, all the time I was directing the DEA, he was teaching the gauge theory and electroweak interactions course with Pierre Fayet. And maybe the last time, or all, one of the last times I remember interacting with Pierre was in the organization of the Marcel Grossman meeting in Paris in 2009. Those of you that know this meeting, it's one that maximizes entropy, like Guy described, but somehow it manages to still happen and hold together. And I remember Pierre agonizing about taming this infinite entropy of the meeting. And where it would happen and under what conditions and so on. Then we had a few interactions, but very brief physics interactions later about gravity waves from cosmic strings. And then our paths diverged. He got very much involved in LISA and gravitational wave detection. Now, despite all his multiple facets, I'm pretty sure Pierre was a theorist at heart. He was perhaps a little more insistent, or, you know, by premonition more pressed than others to see these beautiful ideas realized in the laboratory. And indeed, you know, theorists in our fields often tend to forget an inconvenient truth, which is that there is a time scale that has little to do with fundamental physics, but which unfortunately cannot be completely ignored, and this is human lifetime. And we are all aware, I think, of this, and therefore we are rightfully pressed to see how all these beautiful ideas must somehow be realized in nature. Pierre did live long enough to see at least two of those, the Brout and Glaert Higgs boson. You see, that's about 50 years after the theoretical prediction that it was discovered. And the gravitational waves, which is a century after the theoretical prediction. The average is 75. Now, that's a little tough. But he just fell short of witnessing the smoking gun evidence for supersymmetric string unification. But I'm pretty sure that his nose will prove most likely again right. And this is the subject he spent most of his career on. So again, thank you very much to Pierre, and thank you very much to the organizers of this nice meeting.
Bonjour. I've decided at the beginning to speak, to give the talk in English. But it's late. And I prefer to speak French for a simple reason too. The thing I want to say about Pierre is more easy to say that in French. L'image que vous voyez ici, c'est Lisa. Je ne parlerai pas de Lisa ici, parce que vous aurez un talk demain de Stefano Vitale qui va vous expliquer tout. Et beaucoup d'entre vous connaissent Lisa. Je parlerai plutôt de... Il y a 15 ans, la France, la communauté française, ne participait pas à l'ISA. Aucun laboratoire. Je ne dis pas qu'il n'y avait pas de gens qui travaillaient dans les ondes gravitationnelles, et on le sait, ou ce que ce soit. Il paraît que j'ai oublié le micro. Il paraît, et il est évident que les gens de Virgo, qui est un team important, ne serait-ce que les résultats qu'ils viennent d'obtenir, et tous les gens en physique théorique qui ont fait des développements plus que fantastiques dans les ondes gravitationnelles. Mais la France ne participait pas. Quand j'ai connu Pierre, qui venait tout juste, d'ailleurs pas encore prendre la direction de la PC, et ça c'est une petite histoire, m'a appelé dans son bureau. Il m'a proposé de m'occuper de l'ISA et de rejoindre le LISA Consortium. Et là, c'est la première force de Pierre, sa capacité à convaincre. Je n'étais pas un homme des zones gravitationnelles et j'ai accepté. Je l'ai regretté pendant un an, parce que c'était très dur pour se mettre au niveau de l'ISA, qui était quand même un système complexe. Mais la deuxième chose, immédiatement, qu'a fait Pierre, ça c'est remarquable. Il a réussi à convaincre le CNRS, IN2P3, le CNES, parce que quand on parle de spatial, on parle du CNES, évidemment, de les convaincre de soutenir que l'APC soit partie prenante de ce prototype qui est LISA Pathfinder. On a eu un premier accord avec le CNRS et un accord avec le CNES. Et le CNES a subventionné la partie APC qui a construit une petite partie de Pathfinder et qui en a aussi fait l'analyse, qui est d'ailleurs toujours en cours. Mais en même temps, Il a su convaincre l'ESA, ce qui n'est pas simple, le LISA Consortium, le CNES par la même occasion, de poursuivre notre effort et qu'on intègre totalement la communauté LISA. Et pour ce fait, il a créé autre chose qui s'appelle LISA France. LISA France, c'était un groupement de 9 laboratoires, si mes souvenirs sont exacts, au départ, qui comportait l'ONERA, l'IAP, le LUT et d'autres. Ça va me revenir au fur et à mesure de la discussion. Ça, c'était important parce que d'une part, ça a été subventionné par le CNES et tous les ans, ou deux fois par an, il y avait un meeting dans un laboratoire pour discuter aussi bien de la technologie en cours de LISA et de LISA Pathfinder, mais aussi de la physique qu'on pouvait tirer des ondes gravitationnelles et de leur analyse. Et ça, c'est toujours Pierre qui était derrière tout ça. Au départ, à l'APC, il y avait 3 personnes, moi-même, qui a été rejoint rapidement par Éric Plagnol, que vous connaissez, je pense, et puis un ingénieur, Pierre Pratt. Maintenant, le groupe APC est important, et petit à petit, on a su, d'une part, grâce à Pierre, à son enthousiasme perpétuel sur ce sujet, à élan, je ne sais comment le dire, sa capacité de travail éblouissante, d'être capable d'aller suivre des choses en cosmologie, mais d'assister simultanément une heure après, en prenant l'avion à l'ESTEC, pour suivre une conférence de l'ESA sur qui fabriquera une partie de l'ESA. Et ça, c'est difficile. C'est des réunions très difficiles. Pierre a su les mener toujours avec calme, et non content de ça, il les a toujours obtenues. Donc maintenant, où on en est, on n'est que la France, par un groupement qui ne fait que s'amplifier. Je crois qu'Antoine, qui est là-haut, m'a dit que maintenant, il y a plus de 300 personnes, ou même 600 personnes, qui s'inscrivent dans le cadre, pas uniquement des Français, hein, qui s'inscrivent dans le cadre de LISA. Donc LISA, maintenant, va prendre son envol. Non content de ça, tout le monde le sait, ou alors je vais vous l'apprendre, mais LISA Pathfinder est un succès. En clair, LISA Pathfinder a prouvé qu'on pouvait construire LISA, et que normalement, il devrait fonctionner. Mais ça, c'était peut-être pas encore suffisant pour Pierre, parce que, en plus de ça, et vous, quelques-uns d'entre vous l'ont dit, c'est qu'il a continué aussi son travail en physique théorique. Il a fait des papiers en cosmologie. Et en outre, il a créé ce fameux GDR avec le CNRS, qui regroupe justement tous les gens qui sont intéressés par les ondes gravitationnelles de manière très indépendante de purement LISA. Donc ce n'était pas un homme de LISA, comme certains ont voulu le dire, c'était un homme des ondes gravitationnelles. Et LISA est un futur détecteur qui va pouvoir détecter, on ose espérer, comme LIGO et Virgo, et dans un autre domaine en fréquence, des ondes gravitationnelles. Je vais vite finir parce que je sens que les gens sont pressés. Il est tard. Voilà. That is in English. Vous pouvez le lire et peut-être le traduire si vous voulez, ou moi je vous le traduis. Je crois qu'il faut dire merci que la recherche française, et évidemment tout particulièrement les gens de LISA, doivent le remercier. Il a fourni un héritage. Cet héritage, j'ose espérer que toute la communauté française, au moins, va pouvoir le poursuivre. Je finirai rapidement par autre chose. Et ça, je crois que c'est ce qu'était Pierre aussi. Tout le monde connaît ça, hâtez-vous lentement, et sans perdre de courage, 20 fois sur le métier, remettez votre ouvrage. Polissez-le sans cesse, vous connaissez ces boileaux. J'ai mis la traduction qui n'est pas terrible en anglais. Mais je crois que c'était Pierre, sa capacité incroyable à revenir toujours avec une cohérence perpétuelle pour finaliser un projet qui lui tenait à cœur, mais dont les gens profitaient pleinement. Je vous remercie.
So good evening. As you have seen all day long, Pierre had multiple talents, and among these talents, he was a brilliant physicist, he was an inspiring teacher, and he was an organizer and a leader for the community. And I was privileged to see him in action during the last 20 years in three examples. So I will try to show you very quickly these three examples. So the first is science. So as far as I remember, the first time I met Pierre was almost 20 years ago. And this was in a workshop in Peresque, which is a very small village isolated in the south of the French Alps. So Peresque, this conference was mentioned by Anne Davis this morning. And during this conference, Pierre gave a talk on extra dimension. So this was in June, July 98, so just before the victory of France in the World Cup. And Pierre gave a talk on extra dimension, which was extremely enthusiastic about it. And at the end of the talk, I went to see him. And during the talk, he mentioned that it would be interesting. So he explained about Horjava-Witten models. And he explained that he mentioned at the end that it would be interesting to study in more detail the cosmology of these models. So after the talk, I went to see him. I told him that I enjoy very much your talk, and I would like to work on this topic if you want me to join to try to think about it. And this is how started a kind of adventure. So Cédric was involved. He was, as he explained, he was a Pierre student at that time. And during several months, we started to work together on this topic. So as far as I remember, we had a kind of regular meeting, maybe every week in Orsay. So I used to come to Orsay. So it was a time where Pierre still had some time available, and we used to spend half a day talking on the blackboard in this new room in Orsay. And each week or each time, we decided to make calculations. And Pierre was very serious, and he did the calculation, and we tried to, all of us tried to do the calculation, and we would meet and discuss about the results. So in the end, so this is what Cédric explained. This is how this idea of brain cosmology by assuming that our universe is located in a kind of brain, in a five-dimensional world. And this is how we discovered this modified Freeman equation, which was a kind of big surprise for the time. And we spent a lot of time during several months to try to understand, to recheck. And this was a kind of very enriching collaboration, because Pierre and Cédric had a kind of background in particle physics, and I came with my background in general relativity, and I think we really managed to merge the two various ideas of this. And so this was the result, this modified Freeman equation. And okay, so I had something to say about the Randall syndrome, but maybe it's too late and I will skip it. And so this paper became had a very strong impact on the community, as Cédric explained, as Geraldine mentioned this morning, and it was published it appeared in May, so it took almost 1 year to think about this. And I remember that initially people would not believe us. So many people I talk, they would not believe us. I gave a talk in Cambridge at the time, and I was attacked during the talk because people said, you must be wrong somewhere. And slowly, people started to understand, and after a few months and a few years, it was a very famous work. So this is the example on science. Let's move to seeing Pierre in action for teaching. So as you heard, he was a very gifted teacher and had the chance to attend his lecture on supersymmetry. So it was given at École Normale Supérieure at that time. So I think it was around 2001. And so it was intending for graduate students, but a few researchers also came to these lectures. And this was somehow the basis for his textbook. And this is from this lecture that he then wrote the textbook. And I remember that it was very, very clear lectures. And somehow he managed to make the topic very lively and at the same time to be very precise and rigorous. So this is the kind of ideal situation when you try to follow a new topic. And finally, the last example where I could see really Pierre in action was the foundation of APC. So the idea of APC, I guess, started in 2000, something around this. So at that time, I was in Meudon, in Observatoire de Meudon. And Pierre convinced me to join APC when APC was going to be founded a few years later. So it was in 2000. At that time, there was a kind of small revolution in Meudon where a group of young cosmologists decided to move from Meudon to IAP. So I joined the group of these young cosmologists, but I told everybody in advance that it was for me just a kind of a step before moving to APC once APC was created. And this is what happened in 2005. So I joined APC. And Pierre offered me to be the head of the theory group. So from the start, I could follow the construction of APC, which was a kind of difficult task because you have to fight many administrative burden and so on. And I was really impressed by Pierre because I knew him as a scientist. I had spent a lot of time discussing physics. And I discovered a new facet. He was able to be really a manager and always by using he was never trying to impose his view, but always trying to convince people. And this is probably the reason that he used to be late on all the meetings, because he would spend so much time trying to convince the people that the next meeting would be a bit later. And just something funny which I remember, because he had become an expert about all the subtleties of the French system, and the French system, for those who know, is very complicated. And I remember, and just for fun, a transparency during a meeting that we had, an internal meeting in APC, where Pierre had prepared a slide, a special slide, to teach us, to explain us the structure of the various labs, what is called LabX, IDEX, and so on. So this is just to show you the... I mean, spending a lot of time to understand, to learn about this and try to explain this. So to conclude, I would like to say that Pierre has left us much too early, of course. But at the same time, many of his legacies are still around us. And I'm sure that some of these legacies are going to survive for a long time. Thank you.
Okay. Good evening. I'll be as brief as possible. It is an honor for me to speak here for a man like Pierre Binetry. In fact, I first saw him, but didn't really meet him when I was a postdoc in Berkeley in late 80s, early 90s, when he was visiting Mary Kay. But I really first sort of casually met him and we discussed when he freshly moved to Orsay in the early 90s, and I was at CERN. However, we didn't interact for many years, and I sort of reconnected when he was actively involved in setting up APC. And at the time, I was at CPHT in Ecole Polytechnique. Once we discussed his project on APC, and about which, in fact, he was very excited. And that was the time that he suggested that I should join the lab. And after some thought, I concurred. And since 2009, I'm officially associated with APC. However, we crossed our physics paths later, after I came to APC, and that's what I would like to briefly mention. I do work on cosmology, but on an on and off basis. And in 2013, I was out from a long series of works that I did with Francesco Nitti at APC and others, which were basically were deriving holographic models for Young-Mills theory, which was based on the ADS-CFT correspondence. And it was around that time that I had a discussion with Lide in Korea, and he explained to me the attractor properties of the Starobinsky model that he was studying at the time. And this was a theory, more or less, that became fashionable because of the CMB data. And that's when I realized that via a kind of vague correspondence, that usually people call it the de Sitter pseudo CFT correspondence, that if I take the Starobinsky model and I look at it from the holographic point of view, then he was using more or less the same potentials we were using to describe the asymptotically free nature of QCD. And for me, that was an incentive to look a little bit at it and eventually present an extension of this DS-CFT idea to the analog of renormalization group flows in quantum field theory. And the end point of this was that one could use Wilsonian type of ideas in order to think about cosmology. So this was my side of thinking, which led me eventually in contact with Pierre's ideas, which he had at the time. Pierre at the time had read a paper of Slava Mukhanov, who was proposing, in fact, the parametrization of cosmological theories in terms of the number of e-foldings. And although I don't remember the reason we started discussing about this, it was very soon obvious that we were more or less having the same ideas coming from two different directions, and we decided to collaborate. And as he usually would do, he would involve his students, and there were three of them, but in fact, listening to Cedric's talk, now I'm not sure that all of them were his students, because I've seen only one of the names in Cedric's student list, but it was Mabillard, Pieroni, who is also here, and Rosset. This is what eventually we wrote, and what we essentially did was to use the Wilsonian ideas about renormalization group flow and using beta functions, in fact, to sort of classify cosmological models in the same way we classify quantum field theories in universality classes. So many different models are essentially the same universality class, same physics, same observables, at least in terms of what we measure in the CMB, and this was basically the crux of this paper and its practical impact. We also mentioned some more theoretical ideas about how some of the so-called big problems in cosmology could be viewed in a different way from a holographic point of view, but we didn't make progress, and this remains, in fact, an open problem. I think I did enjoy very much working and discussing with Pierre, as we heard from many other people. To quote another postdoc that was in APC recently, and which was Valerine Domke, and she mentioned it, in fact, in the movie, Pierre would usually appear at my office at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night, and he would say, I have some time to discuss, and then he would come in and we would discuss physics. But that was, at least in his latest years, the only way to discuss physics with Pierre, if you weren't in committees and in things like that. Well, Pierre is not with us anymore, and his contribution to physics and the physics community is enormous. However, his work and legacy will live on, certainly much longer than any of us will be here. My only regret is that he could accomplish even more, but I always would like to think of him smiling and bright as he always was. Thank you.